Jewish story, we're going to talk about the Baal Shem Tov, how the Baal Shem Tov once, a person asked, he wants to see Mashiach, the Messiah, the redemption. So the Baal Shem Tov, the master of the good name, the Rabbi Y Ccohen Baal Shem Tov, told him to go to this in this town, and there's a family, and to spend Rosh Hashanah with him. So he went to this town, and he was listening outside the door, and there was a widow with a number of children, and she didn't have what to eat. And finally he knocks on the door, and he says, the Baal Shem Tov sent me here to help prepare to prepare a meal.
Right.
So they prepared the meal, and finally he came, and they were very happy, and then finally they came and they had the Yom Tov together, the joyous meal. And then he went back again. And then afterwards he went back on Passover, and we all know Passover is a moment of freedom, a time of freedom. And the idea was Passover, he said, look, Eliyahu HaNobi, Elijah the prophet is coming. And this was this fellow who kept helping this family in need. So today, when we're at a time in history where people need not only help physically, but they need help emotionally and mentally and so on, the idea is to provide for them and to help give a helping hand to both Jew and non-Jew, to both young and old, short and tall, men and women, and so on. So Shalom, I would like to share some words of wisdom with you, with our audience here in Manhattan or around the world. Would you like to tell a story about what the challenges that face today's youth, and how one can deal with the craziness of the world around us, that today everything has got to be me, I, now, everything is how do we do it?
Go I think it's okay. I think today's youth are on track.
Okay, so I also agree that.
I think they're on track.
So what, give us a word of inspiration. Go ahead, look over there in the camera.
So
tell our viewers out in TV land, in TV land, go ahead.
Shalom Aleichem. So I'll tell you another Baal Shem Tov story. Okay. One deserves another. You
okay,
know?
Go ahead.
One deserves another.
Yeah. Or you want it, whatever you want to talk about.
See,
okay.
So the story goes like this. You know, Baal Shem Tov is a very holy Jew, and he could read a person's soul on their face. You know, on the face, he saw the soul, and he saw a simple person, but he saw that this simple person was very holy. This holiness was radiating from his face,
mm-hmm.
and the Baal Shem Tov wanted to know what it is about this person that imbues him with such a spirit of Hashem.
Of God.
Yeah, of God.
Right.
Hashem, God,
right,
Hashem
right,
is God.
Right.
So the Baal Shem Tov followed him.
Mm-hmm.
And finally the Baal Shem Tov asked him. And the man invited the Baal Shem Tov into his home.
Yeah, go ahead.
Baal Shem Tov invited this man into his home. And the Baal Shem Tov, he told the Baal Shem Tov his story. And his story is like this. He says that he as he approached old age, his wife, his longtime wife, passed on from this world. And at that point, he started having regrets about his life. He felt that he hadn't accomplished enough in this lifetime.
Okay.
And this bothered him. Yeah. So he prayed, and his wife came to him in a dream, and his wife told him, you're a simple person, you milk goats for a living, you sell milk for a living, but this is what you have and this is what you can give, so use that. And what he did with that is he gave it to sick people. He
helped
him discreetly helped people out.
Right, there's a famous
sick people
right.
and nursing mothers and whatnot.
Which brings me to a very good point, that the idea that when we help another person physically, you know, it's when you help someone who doesn't have what to eat or someone needs a kind word, you're actually helping doing something real. You're mimicking God. And that is what God wants us. He set us on this earth for each and every one of us to present godliness and goodness into the world. And the way we present godly goodness and kindness and godliness is by revealing the good that exists, that it's inherently in the world.
Right.
And this is what I wanted to talk to you about, the idea that the challenges that face the youth face today. The youth are the most dynamic in the sense that, let me explain, they have the most challenges, they're most advanced, they have much, they have all the gimmicks, they have all the ideas in the world, everything's at their fingertips.
They have more power than anyone ever enjoyed.
Right. And the idea is to be able to realize that this is, that they're in the driver's seat, they're in a fast plane, you know, you can either go very fast, very...
They're driving us.
Yeah, the idea, okay. Let's talk about some of the idea of a maimer. We're learning in the maimer that a little chassidus. Let's talk about the idea of anonisiv malka, or that I want a king. There's a story in the parable in the Medrash, which talks about, and this is going from Yudalf Nissen, which was just Yudalf Nissen, the idea that there was three people, or a few people that were in the palace, and each one had the ability to choose someone. So someone chose a duke, or the governor, or the mayor, and comes a smart person. He says, "I'm going to choose the king." Anonymous Malkus. The question is asked: why do you need to be smart to choose the king? You know, because the explanation is basically that the Jewish people serve God not because of an ulterior motive to receive anything from it, but the whole idea is to serve God. And whereas the nation's looking for ulterior motives rather than to serve the king. The idea is to serve the king is the most pleasurable and most honorable task that anyone could bestow on a person, is to serve Hashem. And this is where the challenges Hashem gives every one of us, to serve Him and to look at the goodness and kindness that exists in everyone.
Maimonides writes that when he was serving, I think they called him the caliph then, yes? When he was serving the caliph,
the sultan,
yeah.
Right.
It wasn't a paid position. It was considered an honor to serve the sultan and his family, and it wasn't a paid position.
Right.
And so, likewise, the Jewish people, we're not here for reward. It is an honor for us to serve Hashem and His cause directly.
And the idea that each and every one of us could serve. It's a very good point that you brought. Moses Maimonides lived in the 12th century in Egypt, in Fez, in Cairo, and he also lived in Spain. He was an interesting scholar. He was a great scholar. He wrote many, many books and many, many treatises and many, many works from the Mishnah Torah, Yad HaChazaka, to the Mor Nevuchim, which is the Guide to the Perplexed. But one of the amazing things about the Rambam, he explains in the last chapter of Maimonides, he says that when the whole world will be filled with the knowledge, when Mashiach comes, redemption comes, the entire world will be suffused with the knowledge of God, both Jew and non-Jew. He says, the Rebbe explains that the world will be suffused with the knowledge of God, and what will be the entire tasks of every individual? To seek out and to study the knowledge of God. And there won't be any more war, famine, no more bloodshed, etc. And this is very powerful because today we're living in the times of Mashiach, the times of redemption, where each and every one of us have the ability to, the Rebbe said, we're the last generation of Galus, of exile, and the first generation of Geula, of redemption. And the question is asked, if we're the first generation of redemption, then obviously, by default, we're going to be the last generation of Golos, of exile.
That's right.
So why do you repeat, why is the double expression, the last generation of Golos and the first generation of Geula? The answer is given because each and every one of us could choose to live in the past and live in exile and live a selfish life, a meaningless life, a selfish and a very cruel and cold life, or you could turn the page and live the life of Mashiach, of redemption, where in that time people will not fight over money, because there'll be enough money and there'll be enough food for everybody. The world knows that with the technology today, we could feed feed every single person on the face of the earth. The earth, with the machinery today, and the planes.
The earth can provide.
If we implement the technology we have here in America, or in the Western world, in Africa, or in the Middle East, for that matter, and everywhere, there is no question that the world could sustain itself.
The earth is more than capable.
Right. 7 billion people.
The earth is more than capable. Providing for the whole population and much more. And this is what the prophet spoke of when they said that the sword will be beat into a plowshare. If we put our energy into feeding people instead of war machines, then we will see the fulfillment of the promises of the prophets.
Right. So the idea is that each and every one of us could make that world. Tell us, you're a wise person. Let's hear some of your wisdom. Share some Torah wisdom with our viewers. Would you like to share a story or some sort of a vart in Chassidus?
So, you have to trigger something.
Okay. Let's talk about freedom. A person being free. Chayrus. We're coming up to Passover. How does one? Everyone has the Mitzrayim means limitations. That each and every one of us have limitations, boundaries, inhibitions, comfort zones, etc., etc. How do we go out of this? You see this Mitzrayim going out of Egypt, which the idea of celebrating Passover is going out of Egypt. You could be sitting at a Seder with matzah and maror and have all the four cups of wine and still be in Egypt, meaning in your own Egypt. How do you break loose? How do you break out of your own Egypt? You know, it's not just going through the motions. Is that a good question?
It's a good question.
Practically.
Practically and a practical.
Talk philosophical.
Philosophically. And in the words, there was a poet, Bob Marley. He says that only you can free yourself, meaning that everything is inside a person. Everything is inside. There's nothing outside that inhibits a person anymore, or that imprisons a person. The prison and freedom is to be found inside, and the person just has to let go inside and has to become one with the universe, one with Hashem, and he has to let go of his own. Of his own chains that he imposes upon himself.
How do you do that? The Yetzirah, the evil inclination, has people...
Stop trying to control. That's the answer. A person tries to control, he has to realize he can't control.
First of all, a person has to realize there's a battle, there's a war going on inside of you.